The following is a presentation of Spurs Broadcasting.
Last season could easily be characterized as a season of ups and downs. We started the season with high hopes and expectations. We were on national television against the Lakers. But we had our two starting guards on the bench with injuries. It seems as if that was sort of a sign of what we were going to be facing for the season. We had injuries that we didn't expect. We had off-court distractions that we certainly didn't expect. And through all of this, our players and our coaches put together 55 wins and back-to-back Midwest titles. Really, a lot of credit is due to you, our fans. You are known around the league as the best fans in the NBA. By the best fans, that means that other teams don't like to come into Hemisphere Arena because they know that the fans add that dimension that makes it difficult for them to win in Hemisphere Arena. We appreciate that because your help is going to help this team have another exciting year. We're all disappointed about what happened out in Oakland. We really feel like we're a better team than Golden State. Excuse me, Donnie. But we're ready to go. Our coaches, our players are looking forward to this year. We do have high expectations. We do expect the Hemisphere Arena to be the place where the good times roll, and we're looking forward to seeing you there this year.
It takes 12 players, a few coaches, and a ball. Seems simple, but in the NBA, it's a well-known fact.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Stan Kelly, welcoming the world's greatest fans to the noisiest arena in the NBA.
Yes, it's a well-known fact around the league that the fans supporting the Spurs are just as dominant of a force as a team itself.
Sometimes I have to stop screaming because I can't even hear anything. It's noisy. It is noisy.
A 33-8 home court record for a season which also produced 40 of 41 regular season sellouts. If domination came with numbers, then take heed to these digits. The Spurs set a franchise attendance record with 651,965 fans, eclipsing last year's mark with three games left to play. Season tickets were also at a premium as the Spurs reached their goal of 12,500 seats. In fact, the Spurs had to ask prospective season ticket holders to join a hopeful group called the Spurs Reserves to be the next in line for season passes for the arena and the Alamo Dome.
I'm Greg Simmons. At the end of the 1989-90 season, it was common knowledge the Spurs were the up-and-coming team in the NBA. David Robinson, Sean Elliott, Rod Strickland, and Willie Anderson, along with veteran Terry Cummings, made up the core of this growing giant. However, through all the success of the 1989-90 Midwest champions, a sophomore jinx seems certain in this storyline. No one team should be so gifted and successful in such a short period of time. Well, the jinx did hit, in a way. Virtually injury-free last season, this year's crop of Spurs couldn't slow the onslaught of ailments and maladies. Young and relentless, though, this team would not let the injuries devastate them. Fighting back, persevering, and above all, winning were the ingredients necessary to make the Spurs back-to-back division champions, an accomplishment a whole city could be proud of.
Shalom begat Hilkiah,
and he shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children.
Though young and not yet fully seasoned, the Spurs wooed practically the nation with its unlimited potential.
Well, that's it. My old friend Duke Zeaver standing by. We'll get some coffee. We'll get some matzo ball soup. I love the San Antonio Spurs, by the way. If you're betting in the NBA this year, I think they're going to win it all. So I guess there's nothing more to say but...
Okay, you would think the Spurs were destiny darlings one day into the season, as in front of a national audience, NBC's first NBA telecast, David Robinson and Terry Cummings shut down Showtime with a come-from-behind 110-99 win over the Lakers.
At halftime, before the coaches came in, we talked about being more aggressive, making them do a lot of things they don't want to do, and not letting them do what they're used to doing. And And then we were still giving them the same outside shots. They just weren't making them.
How would you rank this win? I mean, knowing that you had to go in here without your starting backcourt, a new season. I mean, you're basically injury-free last year.
It real simple, Greg. This is the greatest win of 1990.
But even from the get-go, there was a sneaky feeling that this team should add a red cross to their fiesta stripes. A nagging foot injury kept upstart guard Rod Strickland out of the lineup, and famed Laker killer of the past two seasons, Willie Anderson, was sidelined with a stress fracture.
Injuries is a positive, really, because you can't be successful unless you've gone through some adversity. And as a coach, you find out a lot about the character of your ball club with adversity.
No one injury affected the Spurs more than the one midway through the season to point guard Rod Strickland. A broken hand suffered in an incident at a local nightclub left the club without its point guard for 8 weeks. In that stretch, the Spurs fell from a dominating 31-11 record to 41-22, winning just 10 out of 21 in his absence.
That injury was costly to me and to the team and to the city of San Antonio. And, you know, it was unfortunate, and, you know, I regret the whole situation. But, you know, hopefully I can make amends next year.
While the Spurs were hurting through many parts of the season, there was always one certain Spur who inflicted his own brand of pain. Here's to the Admiral David Robinson, the enforcer in the paint. This was a season of coming of age in the NBA. No longer a rookie in the league, like he ever was to begin with, Mr. Robinson made his presence known in a big way, and early on in the season looked to be a top contender for the league's most valuable player award.
He had an amazing year. And he had a lot of people trying to stop him. And a lot of people did different things to him physically. And, you know, I think we were all real proud of him. And the nice thing is there are a lot of things he can improve on. And I think after the experience we had at the end of the season, I feel he'll be dedicated to work this summer and improve.
MVP credentials? The stats tell the story. Through the course of the 1990-91 campaign, Mr. Robinson led the league with rebounding, finished second by a fraction to Hakeem Olajuwon in blocked shots, while also finishing in the top 10 in scoring and field goal percentages. But wait, there's more. Mr. Robinson needed to make more room in his trophy case for the season round of accolades. For the second straight year, Robinson earned the Schick Most Outstanding Player Award. David was also named to the All-NBA team as well as to the All-Defense Second Team. And then an honor that will come in due time, the league's most valuable player. This year, David finished third behind winner Michael Jordan and runner-up Magic Johnson. Not bad company.
I feel like I really haven't accomplished anything. I feel like there's so much more for me to do. I can improve in great leaps and bounds, really. Every time I see myself play every day. You know, all the people around the country really see is the highlights, so they think I'm great. But I see what happens every day, and I know that I can get so much better that, you know, I'm amazed at how good our team can be and how good I can be.
Big Dave improved a lot this year, and I think he's going to continue to improve. I think he, everybody knows he still needs to work on some aspects of his game, and I think he knows that, and hopefully he'll accept the challenge. I think he's the kind of person that will accept the challenge and want to be the best center in the league, and if he does that, there's no question he's going to be one of the great ones.
He's far from up and coming. He's already there. He's at the top of the mountain. I would say that right now, David Robinson is playing the best basketball of all big men in the world.
Mm-hmm.
I love David, and I think the whole world loved David Robinson. I loved him when he was in the service, and I like him since he's really in the service of the NBA. He's one of the greatest ball players I've seen in many years, and he haven't reached his potential yet. He has a whole lot more to come.
David is going to be, the greatest center to ever play in this league. That's including Bill Russell, Will Chamberlain. I mean, back then in that era, it was much different, you know. They changed the rules of the game, but I'm not going to compare who's better, Akeem, Patrick, but that's just how I'm going to leave it. David is down here and Patrick's here. And, you know, that means he hasn't reached his full potential yet.
From the San Antonio Spurs, David Robinson.
In what is now and should always be an annual event, Mr. Robinson made a visit to the All-Star Game. However, this year, different from last, David was the fans' choice. The first Spur to be selected to the starting lineup since Alvin Robertson in the 1986-87 season. As one of the NBA elite, Robinson showed the reason why he was picked as an NBA All-Star. But on the other side of the coin, there were others who showed David why they were All-Stars. It's all the learning and fun experience for the Admiral.
You know, something like that you never really expect, especially this early in my career. I felt like I had played a good first half of the season, and I felt like I deserved to be there, and it was just a good feeling. All the hard work that you put into it finally pays off, and you and other people are patting you on your back. It's a great feeling.
After the amazing 56-win season and Midwest Division Championship of the 1989-90 campaign, the year would bring some changes. What eventually developed was a slight overhaul. The starting five was left unfazed. But the bench obtained a whole new look. As a matter of fact, until the return of David Wingate midway through the year, the only returnee was Reggie Williams.
You know, through attrition, you might say Johnny Moore, Mike Mitchell, Caldwell Jones, they all just kind of retired on us. So we had to get some new people, and I think we were very fortunate in the draft that we were able to get where we were drafting. We were able to get some guys that kind of project type players, and Dwayne Shintzis and Sean Higgins and Tony Massenburg. They didn't get a whole lot of playing time, but we have great expectations for them.
Draft day proved to fill some holes, and one huge hole left by the retirement of center Caldwell Jones was surprisingly filled by a huge guy in his own right, the highly publicized Dwayne Shintzis.
It's a shock. I just spoke to him on the phone. I think the most surprised guy in America right now is Dwayne Shintzis, realizing he's going to play for us. But you're never going to get a chance to draft a kid with that kind of ability and that size where we will be drafted.
I think I'm a good person, and my basketball abilities will soon speak for themselves. I just want to try to help out the team the best I can and just go down there and get started with my life again.
Talk about changing the face of the team. An already young team added two more baby faces in rookies Sean Higgins and Tony Massenburg. Though spending much of the year on the Pines, their importance to the team was immense.
We probably were the youngest team in the league, or as young as any team. And when you consider we had success and then kept three rookies, that's remarkable. But we had a great draft. And the three young players, even though they didn't play a lot, I think made us feel like they're going to be productive players in the future.
I took it as an honor to be a part of a team of that caliber. You know, most rookies that come in, they might get picked up by a lower division team, and not have the opportunity to go to the playoffs or play with great veteran players like we have. So I felt it was a great opportunity for me to learn a lot this year.
Press conferences seemed to abound during the off months. In the search for that perfect formula, the Spurs first dealt away forward Frank Murkowski to the Bucks for defensive help and leadership in guard Paul Pressey. With the early season injuries to Strickland and Anderson, Pressey's presence was immeasurable in helping the Spurs get off to a great start, thus proving his extreme value right off the bat. Meanwhile, the baby faces were greeted with an interesting mix of veterans, the last of whom to don the black and silver was the experienced rebounder and strongman, Sidney Green. For Sid Vicious, the early going was a rough road. hobbled by bone spurs in both ankles, Sidney was just not the player the Spurs had traded for. He was hurting, and he knew he had to fight back.
Always been a type of player that just, it takes me a while to get accustomed to my surroundings, and it took me a while. I mean, it took me a real long time, and the injury even prolonged it even more, so.
After the All-Star break, Green was able to stand firmly on his feet and kicked into the gear for which he was acquired. Grabbing rebounds off the bench and putting the fear of the Spurs into the opposition made Green a valuable piece of the puzzle going down the stretch. Two of the other new faces included the return of former Spur David Greenwood. While not getting too many minutes, Greenwood's value came as a leader on the bench and in practice. Another Spur with a lot of influence was the littlest one, a mid-season acquisition named Avery Johnson. AJ's quick penetrations and pinpoint passes quickly made him a fan favorite.
Well, I like to go out there and, number one, just hustle. Play hard every minute that I'm out there, whether I'm out there for 4 minutes or whether I'm out there for 34 minutes. So one thing the fans know with me is I like to play real hard, aggressive. I love to dive on the floor and get balls and just play aggressive out there. I don't want to ever play passive when I'm out there.
Along the course of a 55-win season, there are a few milestones, a few victories down the road that are quite memorable, the first of which for the Spurs came the first game of the season against the Lakers, as we previously touched on. But the second month of the season produced pure terror for teams hosting the Spurs. These rude guests went on a December tear, winning the franchise record 6 road games in a row, the exact number of road games played in the month. Why couldn't December last an entire season? From there, the Spurs made meat of a couple of the East elite with season sweeps of Chicago and two-time defending champions Detroit. The big wins were all well and fine, but the Spurs couldn't get over a phobia of the Western Conference's number one team, the Portland Trail Blazers. That is, until the last week in February. In the span of just 2 games, the Spurs turned pain and memories of Portland into a fortune of back-to-back wins over what was then the top team in the NBA. The second win was a milestone in another big way, as it marked the franchise's 1,000th win, a special mark for a team with a proud past. Talk about growing up. Sean Elliott took the Spurs by the reins, filling the bill of promise for a 3rd overall pick in the 1989 draft. No longer timid, Elliott, along with Robinson, was a rock in the lineup as the only 2 players to play in every game this season.
The NBA voted Scott Skiles as the most improved player in the league, but I think you could make a legitimate case for Sean Elliott. He became one of the premier defenders in the league. He improved his offensive output. He was just fun to coach.
Just an average comparison from his rookie to sophomore season in the league shows just what an impact Elliott had on this team. But what's more than that, Sean has become a leader of sorts, a role model for the Spurs.
Seeing Sean Elliott, the way he comes out every night and just breaks his tailbone running up and down the floor and guarding the hardest people, and he's so enthusiastic and he's got such a youthful attitude about it. It really pumps me up. I love playing with Sean. I call him my blood brother, because sometimes we feel like we're out there and we're fighting against the world.
I thought it was much better than my first year. I played with a lot more confidence. Things were just going well for me the whole year. The coaches pumped me up the entire year, gave me a lot of confidence, and I thought I was playing with a lot more confidence. That was really the key for me the entire year.
It's hard to fathom Willie Anderson in just his 3rd season in the pros being the Spur with the longest tenure. Mysterious and soft-spoken, Willie struggled at times in finding the rhythm. But when he did kick in, watch out.
He had some injury problems this year that kind of set him back a little bit. And I think Willie, healthy, we would have seen the improvement right from the start. He's real sensitive, and I think when he wasn't able to perform up to the level he was accustomed to, it really affected him.
Willie was tagged by many as inconsistent, mainly because expectations were high. But the fair assessment comes in the numbers, which show Anderson considering his role as consistent as they come. Exposure. The San Antonio Spurs, a household name? Who would have thought 2 years ago after a 21-win season? But with success comes demand. Everywhere you look, you don't see Spurs paraphernalia. You'd eventually wind up seeing the big guy, Mr. Robinson. The neighborhood is expanding and the airwaves are his domain.
Who could that be?
It's Charles Barkley.
It's Coach Brown.
It's the pizza man with today's lunch.
Commissioner Stern is a great commissioner.
Bow! Gary's pretty smart. You missed the spot.
Not that anyone is jumping on the Spurs bandwagon or anything, but after a little success, the arena started to challenge the Great Western Forum when it came to stargazing. A face in the crowd. You were just a face in the crowd. In the street. It's obviously the heyday for the Spurs. Never before has San Antonio experienced such glamour and success on the court. But through it all, the franchise has not turned its head away from its roots. That's why the annual Reunion Classic has become a marquee weekend for the organization. For the second year, two generations of former Spurs have reunited for a weekend of fun and hoops. This year's returnees included Swin Nader, Kobe Dietrich, Artis Gilmore, new fan favorite Skeeter Swift, and the main attraction, the return of the Iceman, George Gervin.
It is quite a thrill, just being, back in uniform and on the floor with my ex-teammates, was a thrill in itself. We had, many great games on that arena floor with a lot of the guys, the ex-basketball players, ex-Spurs basketball players, and it just made it very exciting to us.
The Silver won the game 18-8 behind a stellar 7-point performance from the Iceman. However, regardless of the score, it was a time to sit back and reflect and enjoy a proud history that spans 17 years and two leagues. Also, as the popularity grows, so does the awareness of the community that makes the Spurs so popular. Giving back to the people, especially the kids, is a major goal in the Spurs organization each season. One example of this was their Stay in School rally on March the 30th. Over 8,000 kids and parents from schools all over the San Antonio area gathered on a Saturday morning to pledge their commitment to stay in school. And in the Spurs tradition, the time spent in the arena was thoroughly entertaining. If the rhythm feels good to you, baby, let me hear you say. While you thought David Robinson was a spotlight player on and off the court as a new up-and-comer, the wily veteran Terry Cummings had his own talking to do. The number two scorer and rebounder on the team, TC was beset by a plague of injuries that took away from a big part of his game.
I think that a healthy Terry Cummings can really make a bigger impact than the one that played here this year.
I don't think you can evaluate Terry based on this year. The first year we had him, he had a phenomenal year. I think last year he was hurt the whole season, and a lot of people didn't realize that, and it really affected his game. And Terry's got a lot of pride, and the fact that he couldn't perform up to the level he was accustomed to really affected him.
Though hobbled with back problems and a broken hand, Cummings' numbers were still among the tops on the team, and he did reach a personal milestone, reaching 15,000 career points. However, when he couldn't offer his talents on the court, TC was always there to guide as a prominent team leader.
I formed a real close bond with Terry Cummings last year, and I think, just being around him and learning some of his power game really helped me a little bit.
In terms of blending talents, Terry Cummings was a front-runner in the organization. As if the grueling 82-game schedule wasn't enough, TC took on the task as broadcaster for the weekly Teammates television show and WOAI's weekly Terry Cummings show, At the same time, TC remained as one of the most accessible players on the team, reaching out to the community, especially the kids. Then there's Rock, the Rocket that was so crucial to the Spurs' success. Many times in this sophomoric season of sorts, as Rodney goes, so go the Spurs. At least that's how it seems.
I don't think that's fair to put it on Rodney, but with the emphasis changing to small, quick players in this league, it's obvious you can't go anywhere unless you have a point guard that is focused and a leader and playing up to his capabilities.
You know, I was on my way to showing what I can do as far as toning down my game and making the right decisions, and I was doing that up till the injury, and I think that just set me back, back a lot.
Rod's unique flair and reckless abandon, coupled with the rest of the power and talent of the season's team, made Strickland a human highlight film at times, thus a fan favorite. Yet, as we all know, this was a year of maturation for Rodney, a year he'll never forget. On the cutting edge at times this past season, on and off the court, Strickland says he is aware of the changes that need to be made.
It's a maturing process, and you know, it's something that I'm looking forward to attacking this summer and coming back in next year with a whole different attitude as far as that's concerned.
It was the milestone of a year ago and probably the harder pinnacle to reach with improved rosters. The Midwest Division was up for grabs and 56 wins for any team seemed to be a long shot. However, as well we know in this day and age, things don't always turn out as predicted. The front runner for the Midwest Division title looked to be the Dallas Mavericks. The additions of Alex English, Fat Lever, and Rodney McRae was to lift Dallas a step higher than the rest of the division. Injuries and a lack of chemistry knocked the Mavs out of contention early. Replacing the Mavs in the Midwest race were the surprising Houston Rockets. With Hakeem Olajuwon out several weeks, the Rockets started an uphill climb that ultimately put them right in the thick of the division race. And as expected, the Utah Jazz were either in first place or a stone's throw away from the top spot all season long. This made for a very tight and very intense race going into the final 3 weeks of the season. The Spurs, for a while, were in the driver's seat. But ultimately, on the stretch run, the Jazz had the upper hand when it boiled down to the schedule and home games. The final week of the season was a roller coaster of emotion for the Spurs. After bowing to the Sonics, San Antonio's lead melted to 1. 2 days later, though, the Spurs handled the Suns. It was a real confidence booster.
Well, today was real important for us. Obviously, this takes the season series from Phoenix, so if we end up in a tie with them, then we'll get the home court advantage. But hopefully, we'll play better in the last four games and we'll get number 2 seed. So we got to feel good about today's win.
After a confidence builder blowout against the Clippers, it was showdown time in the state of Texas, an I-10 shootout at the Summit in Houston. A win would give the Spurs a more comfortable situation in these uncomfortable times, and it would knock the Rockets out of the title contention. A loss, and we've got a whole new ballgame. Well, it took 21 points in the clutch from Terry Cummings and solid performances from the remaining starting five to gun down the Rockets 102-95. It was the biggest character-building, big-pressure win of the season. The Spurs now had a one-game lead over Utah, and Houston was out of it.
Denver is a team that can put many points up on the board, and you know, you never can tell what can happen in a game like that, and we got to stay focused. This game is over, and we got to think about playing Denver now.
The title seemed just a blink of an eye away, for the final two games of the year were against the Midwest cellar dwellers, Denver and Dallas. It was figured to be a couple of easy W's. As the case all season long, every team in the league was shooting at the Spurs. No longer the spoiler, San Antonio became the get-up game. That was oh so apparent in Denver. In the next to the last game of the year, with nothing left to lose, the gutsy Nuggets tripped up the Spurs, thus throwing the quest for the Midwest Division crown into a prayer for a miracle.
The Denver game was a big game for us because we had control of our destiny as far as position for playoffs. And we did not come through like we should have to win that ball game. We had to wait and depend on someone else to finish up the season to put us in position to have home court advantage.
The lights were dimming even faster on any hope of a division title, especially after the Jazz defeated the Lakers to pull into a tie with the Spurs for first place with one game left to go in the season. Since Utah won the season series 3-2 over the Spurs, the Jazz would win the tiebreaker should both teams finish on top of the division with the same record. In other words, the Spurs had to beat the Mavericks and the Jazz had to lose to Golden State on the final day. A minor miracle. The Spurs kept up with their end of the bargain by soundly thrashing the Mavericks 135-101 and thus were clinging on the prayer that the Warriors would play the spoiler role. Sure enough, fate was smiling on the Spurs. A topsy-turvy 55-win season filled with injuries and distractions was a great record, and now it was good enough to win the Midwest Division. Final score for the Golden State Warriors, 114, the Utah Jazz 99. And there were celebrations.
All right!
After the Denver game, I didn't think it would happen, but it's great being the Midwest champs again. I'm really proud of our team, and you know, hopefully we'll play well in the playoffs.
Here was the time all Spurs fans had longed for, the playoffs. A chance to reconcile and erase the memories of the painful Game 7 loss to the Portland Trailblazers a year ago. This was time for destiny to take its course. The first round opponent was our friends, the Golden State Warriors, the team that helped us to the Midwest Division title. Of course, it's the same team that has given the Spurs fits over the past two seasons with their mighty scoring machine. A trio nicknamed Run TMC, standing for Tim Hardaway, Mitch Richmond, and Chris Mullin. These three players ranked in the top 10 in individual scoring and tallying an average of 75.6 points a game together. Game one in the Hemisphere Arena was a torrid affair of offense with a possible war looming. The Warriors were not shy about letting their game plan be known. Get David Robinson out of the game as quickly as possible. Run-ins with Alton Lister and Jim Peterson almost came to blows with Mr. Robinson, but nothing other than a couple of stare-downs resulted. However, the big guy took out his displeasure of his treatment on the Warriors to the tune of 30 points, 13 rebounds, and 8 block shots. But the main man for the Spurs in Game 1 was Willie Anderson. With the green light, Willie took full advantage of the run-and-shoot flavor of the contest to the tune of 38 points. The Spurs weren't shy about putting points on the boards and finally staved off the Warriors with a 130-121 Game 1 win. Game 1 was about all the fun there could be for the Spurs fans this series because the rest of the way was a blur. The Spurs never could establish themselves against the Warriors. David Wingate was hampered by a strained hamstring. Sean Elliott broke his nose in Game 2. Sidney Green missed the final game due to a death in his family. No excuses, the Spurs lost 3 straight and the series to a very hot shooting, resurgent Golden State team. The glory and fervor that come with the playoffs turned into a period of disbelief and disappointment for the players and the staff.
We never played our game that whole 4-game series. The game we beat them playing their game. The last 3 games we lost playing their game. We never really established what we were going to do, and that's what I think more or less, more than anything, cost us the whole series. You know, you have to stick with what got you there, and I don't think that we really, as a team, I don't think we did. You know, and it's not a knock on anybody. It's just that we never went out and established what we were going to do. And in the playoffs, that's the first thing you have to do. If you lose the first 2 games, establishing yourself and win the next 3, then you've accomplished something.
I'm disappointed for our fans because I know how much the Spurs mean to San Antonio and our fans, and we've been blessed with the best fans. And I'm embarrassed, you know, every time I turn on the TV and watch the playoffs, it's a real empty feeling, and I, you know, I think that just makes me more committed to see that we make improvement.
I don't think San Antonio is the kind of city that gives up on that's going to give up on us. Our fans are real supportive, and our fans are real emotional fans. They're good fans. They're like European fans to me. They're real emotional. They get hyped up, and they have a lot of spirit. And I don't think when you have that kind of combination, you're not going to have people that are going to quit on you, that's for sure.
In the NBA, there is only one team that doesn't finish the season on a disappointing note. Here in San Antonio, patience will be a much-needed virtue. Spurs, despite injuries, were a good team. However, champions in this highly competitive league are not made in just 1 or 2 years. It's possible, but the odds are generally against it. There may be some changes in the offseason, but all will be in the hopes of challenging for an NBA championship. That has been and will be the Spurs' primary goal. We're almost there. I've been around this team long enough to ensure you that the players and staff of the San Antonio Spurs are playing not just for themselves, but for a following and a community that is among the elite in the NBA. In the words of former Spurs broadcaster Terry Stembridge, there will be another night.